Good morning to you. Welcome. It's Saturday, the 3rd of January, 2015. My name's Chris Reardon. This is United Kingdom Talk. I do hope you liked a rather amusing new opening title sequence. Did you enjoy that? Eh? That's what we're doing for a while. I'll try and change it a little bit more for the year because we tend to stick with the same one for a long time. So that's the one at the moment. Do you know how long that took me to make? Yep. Try 7 hours. I don't know why, but for some reason I couldn't save it in the right format. The when I say that, you know, like you've got a widescreen telly. Well, it kept saving smaller in like the square telly. And no matter what different numbers I put into the program, it just would not be widescreen. So eventually I saved it in the one format that would work, which is flash. Okay, you don't really need to know much about it, just to let you know, flash. Okay, and then I converted to the Windows Media, which the particular program I used to talk to you on seems to have worked all right. It was blooming hard work, it was. Good morning to Shania. Good morning, Shania, who's with us live 2 weeks in a row. And indeed, Shania, I just caught her around about 10 to 12. I was in my cupboard trying to select a nice shirt to wear today. And I saw Shania pop up and I said, well, if you're there, I suppose I better put a nice shirt on. Would you like blue or green or pink? And she has selected green. And I did say I would iron it, but it got a bit late and I haven't had time. So I'm kind of trying to sort of, you know, pull out the creases as we go along. It's all ongoing maintenance here at United Kingdom Talk. It really is. So I hope it doesn't look too creased up for you this morning for Shania. It was a case of this or my old Sainsbury's T-shirt, you know, which would have been suitable if people just like Daniel in Camberley were watching. Oh, he's there. Good morning, Daniel. Hi, Chris. Nice opening, that terrible shirt. What's wrong with the shirt? I've put this on specially for Shania. The point is, Daniel, you know, in Camberley, you're a little bit... I don't want to sound cruel or not. You're a little bit past it and you may not understand what fashion is now, dear. You know, we're not all walking around in onesies anymore. Thank God I never, ever wore a onesie. I mean, it's just like a large baby grow, isn't it? Whatever possessed people to start wearing onesies? They're just awful. Awful. And they're even worse if, like me, Daniel, and I'm not saying you are, I wouldn't mention people's looks. But if you're a little bit, how can I put this, bit bigger around the stomach, I mean, onesies just look, put it this way, have you watched the Teletubbies? Now, they wear onesies, and they look stupid. Do you know what I mean? So I'm not going to wear a onesie either. Although, after saying that, I'm very pleased to announce I have, since Wednesday, lost half a pound in weight. Thank you very much. Oh, yes. Oh, yes. The New Year's resolution is into day 3. So once again, I've done the same as I did last time. I've cut out... Oh, did I see you flash a call up there, Shania? Were you actually going to call in then? I'm sure I saw a little thing flash up there then. Did I miss that? Try again, Shania. Try again, darling. Yes, you can call in, boys and girls. Call in if you've got Skype. It's all one word, United Kingdom Talk. Okay? United Kingdom Talk is the Skype. There's a phone number as well, local London number, 0208144 3477, 0208144 3477. That's a new number, so delete the old one, that's a new one. Or of course there's email if you want to join in by email as well. Email address chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. All right. Yes, so, I mean, I don't know. I'm pleased. I've knocked out potatoes, bread, crisps, chocolate, well, sweets, and cakes. I know all the nice things, but I did this back last April. Do you remember? And I lost a stone and a half in 3 months. So I'm trying again this year. We want to be at about 12, 11 and a half, 12. Something like that. 11 and a half, 12 stones. That's where I want to be. So I'm only at 13 now, and we'll see how we get on. So I'm really quite pleased about that. We got a phone call already. Good morning. Who is online? Just a moment.
Oh, good morning, Chris Reardon.
29, line 29. Who's calling in, please?
It's me. It's me here. Can you recognise this voice?
Who's me?
Me. Can you recognise my voice?
Who's me?
Keith George.
Is that Keith George?
Chris.
Is that Keith George?
It is, yes.
Are you calling from another... Are we internationally calling today, dear?
I'm internationally calling from Tenerife. We're all watching. My mum has just told me to ring you and say to you, she agrees with you with regards to those ones. They're absolutely awful.
You didn't have one, did you? How many people are speaking at the same time?
The sight of the people when they come out the toilet, because you have to take them all off.
That's a good point. How do you go to the toilet when you've got... You must have to take the whole thing off. You'd freeze your bits off, wouldn't you?
Absolutely.
I think they're I think they're dreadful things, those onesies. Absolutely. You haven't got one, Keith, have you?
I don't possess a onesie, thankfully, because I just had a deja vu moment. And if the doorbell rings, I'm going to scream, Chris.
A deja vu moment? Yes, I do, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm going to take my coffee outside so my family can hear the...
Oh, I wonder what the echoing was going on. I wonder what the echoing was happening there, Keith.
Yeah, so I'm going to go outside. Yes, I haven't got a onesie because I was out once I went shopping, food shopping, in a very well known supermarket, and there was a group of people who had just literally, obviously, just got up, and was out shopping in their onesies.
Yep,
thought, how disgraceful.
Yep, yep.
How disgraceful. The fingernails, black.
Oh no.
Charcoal.
Oh. Oh, and one to and black
rock, my mum said.
Black teeth as well.
I didn't look at the teeth, but the hair, naked hair, are just disgusting, you know. And I thought, oh my god, I don't know what they. Oh, just oh.
You know,
no,
for me,
the onesies.
For me,
and they look like they've been washed.
For me. If they'd been sold perhaps as pyjamas or maybe nightwear or something like that, you know, or even at a stretch, you know, some sort of house outfit, I could just about accept them. But people actually go out in them. My nephew was one of them. He had this onesie, you know, and, oh, it's just awful. Awful, awful, yeah. Awful. Well, I'm glad that fashion's gone, Keith.
Absolutely. I'm absolutely glad it's gone as well. I've never got into that sort of fashion, you know.
No.
I mean, can you imagine some of the people who may have a onesie and, you know, we know them and we know about their personal hygiene.
I think we...
And if you saw them walking about in a onesie, well, I'd be sick.
I think we know, without mentioning any names at all, dear, what sort of people we know, which people that we know would be wearing onesies. I absolutely do. You know the sort. You know the sort. I have to say, there was a certain pub that will remain nameless that had I can't even get over this, a onesie party. A onesie party where everyone turned up in these dreadful so-called fashion items. This is about 2 years ago, I think. They all go, and they were, and that was the party. What was the theme of the party? Oh, let's all wear a onesie. How artistic and original. I mean, you can understand, you know, if you had a party, you know, come as your favourite dead celebrity or something like that.
Yeah.
I could understand that, you know, and you'd have to be a bit creative. Not to just go down to Primark and buy something off a hanger and put it on and say, that's a party. How awful.
I know.
Just
well,
dreadful.
You know, they remind me of what we used to wear when we were children.
Yeah. Yes.
Baby grows.
Yes, that's what I said. That is exactly what I said.
Their baby grows for you know, I'm sure some people like to lounge around them. But I can tell you now, Chris, I am wearing a dressing gown. I prefer the dressing gown.
Yes. I've got a white
dressing gown. I've got a nice dressing gown, and I put that on every morning. Nice cup of tea.
Yeah.
And relax here. You know, it's quite a nice day here today. My niece is sitting on the settee watching you on the television, trying to work out what's going on. Could you say hello to Pearl for me?
Hello, Carol. Hello. How old is she?
She's three.
Three. Does she like nursery rhymes?
Does she like what?
Nursery rhymes.
Yes, she does. Her favourite is Twinkle, Twinkle.
Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star. I shall sing that for her in a moment. We can. You see, we can do all these things, Keith. You know, it's all here. Yeah. I'll have to find it first, though. Did you have a nice Christmas, Keith? And your New Year as well?
Christmas. Lovely Christmas and New Year. And the loveliest part about New Year here in Tenerife is that I was all done by 10 to 12. So it gives me time to get home.
Lovely.
My family chips for the old lang syne.
Could you just tell people what you do for a job, Keith?
I am an London Underground inspector. No,
oh, it's almost as bad as that's almost as bad as working in a post office.
I am a tribute act. I'm a professional singer, firstly. Secondly comes a tribute act to Boy George.
Yes.
Also, I do other characters, and I do drag as well. So a lot of different things. But my niece's name is Pearl. Her name's Pearl, not Carol.
Your mum's name is?
My mum's name is Josephine.
Josephine. And the little girl's name is?
Pearl.
Pearl. Why did I say Carol?
I don't know. And my sister's name is Emily.
Emily, how old is she?
Emily, she's having her birthday, actually, on the 11th of January. She's 7 years younger than me. She's going to be 36.
It's very windy, dear. It's very windy.
It's a little bit windy here. Yeah,
come out of the wind, dear. Come out of the wind.
Because I did go for an Indian last night.
Oh, no. Oh, don't touch any of that foreign food. I've told you before.
It's
very, very bad for you. Don't eat all that foreign muck. Pie and chips, dear. Pie and chips. No, knock out the chips. I've knocked out the chips because I'm on me little bit of a health thing at the moment, dear. I want to lose a stone in weight.
I need to join in, Chris, because I've put on so much weight.
Oh, have you?
It's unbelievable.
Oh, well.
You know what it's like. I mean, you know.
Yeah, but Keith,
once I get focused, I lose that weight.
Does it? Yes. Does it bother you, Keith, that weight or not?
Did it what?
Does it bother you putting on that much?
Yes, it does bother me.
Okay,
of course
fair
it
enough.
Does. When you walk, you walk into a pub and people say because you've got a big belly, there's no dartboard in here.
Don't they always tell you about it? See, my opinion is, you know, if it bothers you, do something about it. If it doesn't, then fine, no problem at all.
Yeah. No, it does bother me, and I will. I mean, I live on a very steep hill, so I mean.
I thought you were about to say I live on a very tight budget, then, dear.
No.
Dear.
Next Wednesday, I'm flying off to Thailand.
Oh, lovely! Yes.
Because I've got a show in Thailand. And
what show is it, Keith?
Pardon?
And what show are you doing?
The Boy George Experience.
Right, so you do Boy George from Culture Club. Do you sing his songs like Karma Chameleon and all that?
All the songs, all the big hits of Culture Club. Right. And also, he had a couple of solo hits that were quite well-known, like Everything I Own.
Yes,
you know?
I know that one, yeah.
And Crying Game.
Right.
So they go into the show. So I basically do whatever I want. Yeah, my mum's come out.
We've all been diagnosed with overactive knife and fork.
Oh, yes. My mum's just said that we've all been diagnosed this Christmas with overactive knife and forks.
Yeah, I've got that. I've had that as well. They just won't stop moving. You know, Miss Jason?
Yes.
Drag act Miss Jason. She used it on the train. She says, I went to the doctor because she's really, really big, but she's lost a lot of weight. Because she had a heart attack, didn't she? She had a bloody heart attack.
Allegedly.
Yeah. So she had to lose the weight. And she, one of the things she said on the stage, she said, I went to the doctor and I said, I've got a terrible weight problem. He said, well, what's the problem? She says, well, I think it's my legs. And the doctor says to her, well, what's wrong with your legs? She said, they keep taking me to the kebab shop.
She said that on the Weakest Link. We did the Drag Queen special of the Weakest Link, didn't we?
Yes.
And Robinson said to Miss Jason, you're a bit big size. You're not feeling like doing exercise.
Yes.
I do exercise. I've got bad legs. And then that gag came out, you know. So, Dan? Yes, that was good. But funny you should mention Miss Jason, because I'm actually will be going to, because Miss Jason does a lot of fundraising for a certain orphanage.
That's right,
out
yes.
in Thailand.
Yes.
So I've sort of made a couple of inquiries, and I'd like to go and visit the orphanage.
Right. Are you going to do some charity stuff as well?
Am I going to? Yes, I'm going to do some charity stuff.
Right.
But
okay.
This event is for towards Pattaya Pride, where I'll be performing.
Right. Okay. Yeah.
Something to do with the Pride. We've always said this, me and you together. I like doing Pride events. You know, I will do a Pride event.
Yeah.
On the assumption that, you know, they treat the artist fairly, because at the end of the day, me and you both know somebody is making a lot of money.
Oh yes, there's always
yes. It's not the people pressing the buttons for us to go on and make the sound and the lighting lovely.
No, it's not.
They get paid a lot of money.
Right.
Somebody does get paid a lot of money, and then they say it's a non-profit organisation.
That's
How do you manage to go on your lovely world around the world trips?
But Keith, that's like a lot of charities. You look how much some of these charity people get, and their argument is, we've got to pay that to get the best people. It's the biggest load of crap I've ever heard in all my life. You're telling me there's not someone who wants to raise money for, like, cancer awareness, and they are willing to do it for nothing? Of course there is.
Yeah.
But it's those people with the money, the people at the top of the charity. I actually stopped giving to charities and those, you know, the boxes. You know, the rattling boxes they have in the street.
Yeah.
Well, how many hands do you think that has to go through till it actually gets to the charity?
I know.
Well, someone along the line will be nicking, so I don't put any money in anymore. I've got only a small direct debit to a charity. I won't say which one. A charity.
Yes.
And I also put a little bit of money in the church collection box every week, because I implicitly trust that gets to where it goes to. And that's the only ones I do. I never give money to the street or anything like that.
Well, you know, we were quite religious when we went up. I don't go to church as much as I should do. I do pray every night.
Yes.
And but when we were younger, I went to church religiously, you know, and I went to a very strict Catholic school.
It got very windy, Andy. Very windy.
I went to a very strict Catholic school, and my mum and that, we used to go to the church on, you know, Friday or Saturday, sometimes on Sunday, and put money in the collection box. And one night, we went to a party at a place called Cipriana's, a very nice restaurant in Battersea, and who was sitting on the next table but two of the priests having a good old joy up.
Two of the what?
Two of the priests. Drinking brandies, having steaks and all that. That's where your collection money's gone.
Listen, Daniel in Camberley, wants to mention one thing to you. Take care in Thailand. There's a lot of men there dressed as ladies. And also, are you having boobs fitted in Thailand? At which carry on.
I've been messing about with my family, saying I was going to get my boobs done.
Also, it is happening, is it, Keith?
No, I wouldn't. Of course, I wouldn't do that. I did wind my mum and my sister up and said, "Oh, I'm gonna have breast implants." And they said, "Why?" I said, "I want to be a lady boy, messing about, you know." And my sister said, "Oh, you're too masculine for that." I said, "Doesn't matter. I know. I've been to clubs where people, when I've been doing my drag shows, I think they would have liked you know, doing my drag shows." And obviously, I do it as a character, Mandy Gap, and then as soon as I come off stage, that's it. But men have come up to me and said, "Oh, if you had real breasts, you know, I'd give you quite a lot of money." And I said, "Well, to do what?"
Well, I don't think we should go there, really. Keith, if you carry on eating as you're eating, you won't need to have them put in. They just grow on their own, dear.
Well, I tell you now, that's my biggest nightmare, because if I woke up one morning and one of my men, what they call it, man boobs, was, and, you know, I haven't got them at the moment, and, you know, I don't want that to happen, so, you know.
Well, I mean, I'm just... If that happens, I'll be honest. I'm just cupping myself now, and I'm thinking to myself, they might be growing a little bit. This is why I'm taking action now, Keith. I've knocked out potatoes, bread, crisps, sweets, and all that business. That's all gone, except for there is a packet of peppermint creams in my fridge that my dear sister made me. She makes me all these things at Christmas. Marmalade, fudge. Oh, her fudge is to die for. Great big bag. Sorry, Keith, it only lasted a day and a half.
because you know when I fly with British Airways, and with British Airways, as a silver member, you're allowed to bring two suitcases, and each suitcase is allowed to weigh up to and including 32 kilos.
Correct, yes.
So,
yes.
Because out here, there are shops like Iceland, but they charge a lot more than the product is worth back in England. So, whether you pay £1 for something here, you're paying €4.50.
Yeah.
I said to my mum, "Look, I'm going to do that. We bought Christmas here. We've had tins of Quality Street. They've all gone nearly. We had two tins of Quality Street, the roses. We had the boxes of biscuits in our family circle."
Oh, yeah. You bought them all over.
The Victoria's one, the matchstick.
I like the orange creams. Orange and strawberry creams are my favourite.
Yeah, we've got matchsticks in every flavour. After eight. packets of Pringles in every flavour. the funniest thing was, we went to Iceland in where my sister lives in Kent.
Yeah.
And if you look at the boxes, and it looked like it was a box of mince pies. You could tell it was a mince pies box because there was a mince pie on the box. But when you looked at the writing, it looked like the word minge. Minge pie. And I said, "Oh my God." But to say, in the survey, Iceland's mince pies came up near top.
Yeah, they did. That's correct. Steve Allen, who's on LBC, is always talking about mince pies around Christmas time. And they beat the... it might be Fortnum & Mason or Harrods was selling a box for like 15 quid. And it beat them hands down, and they're only a pound.
I know. And you get 12.
You do. Keith, lovely to talk to you, dear, on the phone. I'm going to sing to your little niece now.
Don't forget to do the nursery one for my niece.
No, I'm going to do it in a second. Nice to talk to you. What's the temperature like there, Keith?
Pardon?
How hot is it in where you are in Tenerife at the moment?
Today, it's probably right now, it's probably about 22 at the moment.
22, 44, 26. So about 75, 76. Lovely.
Yeah.
Lovely.
In the evening, it's a little bit cold. We've been a bit unlucky because they've had a kalima, which is a sand cloud.
Yeah.
Off the Sahara, because, you know, and it's blown over the island, and everything looks just white.
Yeah, so, Keith, there was another thing I was going to ask you. So Benidorm started again last night, and there is a club.
I'm going to watch it.
Did you watch? Have you watched it yet?
Not yet. No.
Oh, very good. Written by our good friend Darren Letton, who I know you know as well.
Yes. I love him. Yeah.
You know, there is a bar in it, Neptune's. You know where all the entertainment happens. Okay.
Yes.
Anywhere you work is like that at all? Would you?
Not really.
Because I think that would be a wonderful place to work. if there was actually anywhere like in Benidorm. That
actually,
holiday...
yes, there is actually. There's a place out here called Amanda's.
Amanda's?
And Amanda's, and it's in Torrevieskas. And they do cabaret every night of the week. And if people proper come and sit down, you know, and what, they can have a meal or a drink or whatever. And a guy called Sean King, he's there, I think, 6 days out of seven. And he's the host, brilliant host and compere, wonderful sound, wonderful lighting, and just really, really lovely venue to do. So they have every week the same acts on, and when people go away, they get me in, because they can't slot me in. There's no decks available to slot me in full time. But the Sean absolutely adores the Boy George show, and the owners were in when I did one of the last stints over Christmas.
Right.
And they loved it. So, yeah, that's one of the venues. They sit down and they listen, and I love it. You know, they listen to every word you say.
Yeah.
They love the singing. They get up and dance if they want to.
And
it's not dark. It's not as dark as the Neptune bar.
Yes.
A bit more light so people can see what they're eating. It's like a restaurant up there, but I suppose that's what you mean, yeah, where people have to sit and
see, and then,
to you, you know.
And then you've got, like, all the time, you've got the complete change in the audience every few weeks, haven't you? I'm very tempted to sort of look out for something like that. Do you know what I mean? Abroad. Because I've done...
Come and stay. You should come and stay at Villa Villa Blanca.
Yes.
You're more than welcome anytime. You know, come over, have a look about, and see what it's like. I mean, the winter months here, the weather's very nice. It's generally very nice.
It starts getting
very warm, April time, up until October. So, but you know, anytime you want to come out here, just check, we get our diaries together. Even if you just want to come 3 or 4 days or a weekend or whatever, just come and have a look.
Yeah. All right, Keith. Well, lovely to talk to you, dear.
And you.
Have a nice night's work. Bye-bye now.
Bye.
There we are. How fantastic to talk to Keith Georgia, calling in from Tenerife. We'll sing to his niece in a second. Good morning to Terry H. Sorry, Terry, I've made you wait a long time, but I've just noticed a flash up on the side there. I was engrossed in the conversation. Engrossed. Who says, Terry H has got a headache this morning. What's wrong, Terry? You want someone nice in there to massage those little temples of yours, don't you? Have a little bit of a massage on the temples. That's what you need, Terry H. Temple massaging. He says, the shirt is too bright, hurting my eyes. Well, turn your brightness down a little bit, dear. Are you watching from a mobile... Has anyone watched this show from a mobile phone? As a matter of interest. Anyone watch from a mobile phone? Terry says, Joey Essex looks amazing in a onesie. No, he doesn't. No, he doesn't. Joey Essex doesn't look amazing in anything. That, you know, that is my nephew's hero. Joey Essex is my nephew. The same way as, I suppose, Tony Blackburn and Steve Allen are my radio heroes. Joey Essex is my nephew's hero. That's an absolute truth, that is. Yes. Terry H also says, Terry Wogan takes a fee for children in need. Yes, he does. You're quite right, he does. And Terry H also says, Neptune's actually exists in Benidorm. I've been. Is it just like that, Terry? Oh, I want to go there. I was I had a forced night off last night. We got cancelled in the afternoon because apparently there was a flood downstairs in the particular venue that I was supposed to be working in, which I don't believe a word of it. They usually use the term flood or electrical failure when they want to cancel you for some strange reason. I think what's happened is the particular venue has overstretched its budget for New Year's Eve, so I reckon that's what's happened there. But it doesn't matter. So I had a forced night last night. So I went round to my mate Ron's, and his boyfriend was there, Andy, and we watched Benidorm. Well, actually, I insisted they watch Benidorm. They didn't want to watch it at first. But after a while, my best mate Ronnie got into it and thought it was quite funny. But I thought, you know, watching that particular resort, well, I can't remember what it was. So what a fantastic place that would be to work. But of course, you have to have the characters, not necessarily those characters. And I actually believe if you was to go to somewhere like that, it would have its own characters. We love characters, not people that are all the same. It's so boring. This is the problem with television now. They're trying to make everyone look the same. Or the same sort of thing. LBC, you listen to LBC now, that's gone right downhill. There's only a couple of people left now worth listening to. There's Nick Abbott, who's on, he's not on long enough. He's only on twice a week, Friday and Saturday nights, 10 till 1 a.m. There's Steve Allen, who's very ill at the moment. I think he's back at work tomorrow. He does the early morning. He's good. And there's Clive Ball. That's three. Is that all? For me, they're the only ones worth listening to now. The rest of them are so bloody politically correct and frightened of upsetting anyone. And then I've heard people get cut off left, right and centre because they haven't, like, you know, agreed with it. But it's dreadful. Gone right downhill, that is. Terry H says, yes, it's exactly the same. I was there while they were filming last year. Did you do the karaoke, Terry? Did you actually go in there and do the karaoke while they were filming? Well, I get to see you on the television. Eh? Shania says her dad sometimes watches on a mobile phone. So, oh, OK, that's interesting. I didn't know that. I just wondered if people listened on mobile phones and things like that. Right, now we've got Pearl, who's listening this morning, 3 years old, and she likes nursery rhymes, in particular, Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Up above the world so high, like a diamond in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. There's another verse. Bet you didn't know that. When the blazing sun is gone, when he nothing shines upon, then you show your little light, twinkle, twinkle all the night. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Two verses? No, three verses. Then the traveller in the dark thanks you for your tiny spark. He could not see which way to go if you did not twinkle so. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what you are. Last verse, I promise, promise, promise. In the dark blue sky you keep, and often through my curtains peep. For you never shut your eye till the sun is in the sky. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder. All right then, last verse now. As your bright and tiny spark lights the traveller in the dark, though I know not what you are, twinkle, twinkle, little star. Sing along, pal. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder what. There we are. All right, Pearl, a little song for you this morning, my darling. Don't forget, gang, you can join in. You can call in if you want to on the phone, 020-8144-3477, 020-8144-3477, or you can use the Skype. If you've got Skype, you can use that. Just call in on the Skype username, United Kingdom Talk. All right, Skype username, United Kingdom Talk. Let me see if I've got any messages for you this morning. Yes, actually, I forgot about this one. Let me see. There we are. Got that there. Oh, good morning to Marge. Good morning to Marge in Oklahoma, USA, who's watching live this morning. Good morning, Marge. Sad news is I have not received a little package from you yet, but I do remember a couple of years ago, if you send it on like a normal US post, it does take quite a long time to get here. So I wouldn't worry too much, Marge. Give it another couple of weeks, my darling, okay? Got to say good morning to Alan Rolfe. Good morning, Alan, who writes, did you get the Barry Manilow calendar in the £1 shop? I beg your pardon. Don't be speaking about our Barry like that. You mean the new Barry Manilow calendar behind me today, eh? Look at that. The only thing is, I did notice, right, so he's wearing a blue jacket and a black shirt, okay? In the December last year photo, look, same blue jacket. And I think, I dare to say, same black shirt. Now, you would think, as I said in one of the programmes last week, you would think he'd buy a new jacket, wouldn't you? All that money, do you? Although it's a very nice, sparkly jacket. Do I need a sparkly jacket to do this show? That's the question. Daniel says, your singing always brings me to tears. I'm glad. And good morning to Gary Davidson, who's with us as well this morning. Good morning, Gary. Nice to see you today, sir. I bought a couple of nice DVDs to watch. Check these out. Look. Goodbye, Mr. Chips. Now, this is the story of an old schoolmaster who is really hard on his... hard on his... oh, what do you call it? On his pupils. But as time goes on, he softens to them and they all become great friends. And I think at the end, I think he's supposed to leave or something. I can't remember the exact story. Anyway, it was on the television the other night and I just caught the last... I saw it was on the last 20 minutes. And I thought, oh, I can't believe I've missed that. So I bought that on Amazon. One-click ordering, just £5. So I bought that to watch. And also, I'm a great fan of Disney stuff. And this is kind of Disney. Hansel and Gretel Witch Hunters. Now, of course, you all know the Hansel and Gretel film, don't you? Okay? Where she goes, Hansel and Gretel, two children, are abducted, I think, or they enter into a witch's house. And she tries to eat them. Yes. Now, it says here, get ready for a twisted take on the classic tale as Hansel and Gretel have turned pro, coping with the trauma of their childhood captivity by slaying witches for hire. But when the seemingly unstoppable bounty hunters meet their match in an enemy so evil, it'll take all their training, weapons and courage to survive. So I'm looking forward to watching that one as well. Hansel and Gretel at some point. Oh, stop it, Daniel. Stop creating such lies all the time, will you? Honestly, Daniel, will you watch what you type to me? I'm not reading all those things out, dear. It's shocking, it really is. Chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. If you're watching a recording, or indeed watching the live version of the show, if you want to use one of those as well, then please feel free to do so. Chris@unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk is my email address. Now, what else have we got here? Publicity seekers, that's it. Publicity seekers. Boys and girls, look at this one. There's two stories that I've read in the papers this week, gang. One is a couple who went on holiday, right? So the woman is 11 weeks away from having a baby. And they decided to get on a plane and go on holiday. I mean, how stupid can you be? Anything could go wrong at that point, couldn't it? When you're pregnant, I mean, I'm looking at myself, actually. When you're pregnant, you don't want to be taking risks like that, do you? I mean, do you really? Anyway, so the pair of them got on this plane, right? And they were in, I think, Florida. And she's had the baby 11 weeks early. And they've got this bill for like £100,000 from the hospital. Because let me tell you, do not ever, ever go to America without travel insurance. Because if you have to have anything done, it will cost you an arm and a leg. I was speaking to my friend Suko in New York a couple of years ago, and even at that point, it would cost you £500 just to call out an ambulance. £500 to call out an ambulance. Here, we're very lucky in the UK, with the National Health Service free at point of use. We pick up a phone, right, an ambulance just comes. Unfortunately, in this country, it makes people abuse the system. Idiots. I mean, idiots call ambulances out for a broken finger or a sore throat. You mustn't do it. It's you people that are creating such a problem for everyone else. But you don't want to be ill in America. Do not ever, ever risk going to America or indeed any other country without some sort of health insurance. Well, this couple had the baby 11 weeks early, and it said in the paper they're not sure whether their insurance will cover having the baby or not. Now, I don't understand where they're coming from here. How can you not know whether your insurance is going to cover it or not? Why would you just say, it's like when I had my new boiler put in downstairs, okay? Right, so I handed over the money. Actually, I handed over the money after the job was done. But some people, you know, might ask for money before, okay? You hand over the thing, right? And you've made sure that they're going to install a boiler. You don't hand over the money and maybe, or I hope they put the boiler in. No. You've paid for the boilers put in. So why do they think that it won't cover the insurance? Unless, which I think is probably what they've done, right? They didn't tell the insurance people before they went that she was pregnant to save a few quid. Because when you do holiday insurance, you must reveal anything that's wrong with you. One of the things I've got is asthma. That is on my holiday insurance, that I have asthma. Cost me an extra £3 or something like that. Is there anything wrong with you at all? You've got to tell them. A very, very good friend of mine, she had cancer. She's had it twice, and she's been cleared of it twice now. Okay? But at the time, so she tells them she's got cancer, well, they either wouldn't touch her, or the price went up considerably. But you would have to pay that. You know, you have to, if you want to fly insured, you have to pay that, or you're going to take the risk. Because if you're ill in another country, it doesn't come into, you know, a few extra thousands of pounds. It's tens of thousands of pounds. You'd probably have to sell your house. You get people go skiing. I've heard of them as well. They go skiing. No insurance. They break a leg. Next thing they know, they've got a bill for £15,000 from French or Swiss health authorities. You must have insurance. You absolutely must have insurance. So these people were in the paper, and I just couldn't believe it. You know, I thought, do you just want publicity? Is that what this is about? Are you that stupid that you didn't tell them that you were pregnant? Or are you that stupid that you didn't have any health? Well, they said they did have health insurance because they're not quite that stupid, you know. And the other thing, I saw more publicity seekers. I mean, you know, and this was a big story in the Daily Mail online last week. This is no ordinary bug. This is an M&S bug found in a £2.50 portion of creamed spinach. And the story goes, he was enjoying a romantic dinner with his wife, but the mood was quickly shattered upon discovery of a huge bug in his Marks & Spencer cream spinach. It was a cockroach, apparently. And Marks & Spencer sent him a bottle of fizzy wine and £25 compensation. Right? So he wrote to the paper. I mean, what do these people want? That's all they want. They want money. They want money. Give me the money. Give me the money. Dreadful, dreadful people. That's all it's about now. We've got to put a stamp on this. We've got to stop this ridiculous money-orientated society. Someone trips over a paving stone, they immediately try and sue the council. This has all come from America. We never had it here before when I was a child, you know. You fell into someone, it was an accident. An accident. No one kicked you on purpose in the street. It was an accident. But no, they have to go to... And they're all springing up all over the places, aren't they? Idiots. Ah, another telephone call. This one's coming from London. Good morning. Hello?
Oh, hello?
Hello? I've got
Chris, is that you?
Hello, it is me.
But I'm listening to you live on the radio.
Oh, can you just turn your computer off, darling?
It is off, yeah.
Have you got the sound on?
I'm watching you on my iPad.
Oh, that's
I've
it,
it's gone turned
now.
It all down.
A very good morning to you. Is that Anne McCabe?
It's Anne McCabe, but I mean, this is surreal because I'm watching you. Is there a delay?
Well, you've done it before. You've been there before, haven't you?
Yeah, but I'm watching you live and you were talking and then I've just rang you. I didn't hear it ringing.
Oh.
It's all working.
Oh, no. As soon as I see something flash, I grab it quickly.
Oh, we do like a flasher.
Sometimes you have to go on hold, but please be assured your call is important to me and you will be connected to a customer services representative as soon as one becomes available. Please hold the line.
Am I call number what? What number? Hundreds?
Oh, you're on line, let me see, 2,367. Got so many lines coming in.
Oh, do you know, I've been on it an hour waiting to get through, Chris. I mean, oh my God, I've waited and waited and waited.
Have you really?
Happy New Year to you and all your listeners.
Happy New Year. Whereabouts are you, Anne, exactly?
Pardon?
What town are you in?
Oh, the merry town of Lewisham, South East London.
Lewisham, South East London. So let me see, it's 10 to 1. So really, you want to be going out in the next hour. After 2 o'clock, you don't leave your houses in Lewisham, do you? Is that right, darling? Have you got bars up on your window? I bet you haven't, yeah.
No, it's
up.
Quite good. No writing this summer. It was a good year. It was a great year, in fact, Chris. So we're doing all right. Listen, I've rung up to ask you what you think about the new phenomenon that is Katie Hopkins. Do you know about Katie Hopkins and her fat story? And I want to talk to you about Celebrity Big Brother that's coming up this week and my selfie stick. There's been so many wonderful things that's happened this week. So,
well, number one, selfie stick. My dear friend Ron, funnily enough, bought me one of these this week. And I can only describe it as a bit of plastic on the end of a car aerial. Right? Now, I have... Can you see the screen on? Oh, actually, no, you won't see it at the same time. I have a rather chunky phone case on my iPhone, right? So when I put it on the end of the, what's it called again? Selfie stick. When I put it on the end of it, it kind of went to the side. It kept turning. It wouldn't hold the weight. So I had to give that back to him. I think he's using it that himself. So for me, the selfie stick didn't work. Because it's like a car aerial. And you know, like, it's like if you put one straw inside another,
yeah,
and it twists, you can twist it. That's what was happening. So it wouldn't stay in the right place. Have you got a case on your phone at all?
No, you must take the case off the actual phone, definitely, and keep it as light as a feather.
Yeah, the trouble
is... And then just clamp it in, but I've had a very successful result. In fact, last night I came out of a pub... And it was like a man magnet, Chris.
Really?
I will put the picture on Facebook up later. I had about 20 men flocking to me. Yes, it was amazing.
Oh.
It made my night.
I'll have to get another one then.
You'll have to try it out. It's brilliant. Yeah.
I will have to get another one if it's a man magnet, dear. I mean, they're not exactly flocking around. Do you know what? Years ago, Anne... On New Year's Eve, I could be on a stage somewhere, you know, doing my DJ, and at 12 o'clock, there'd be a little queue of people waiting to snog me. No one. Not a single person. All I had this New Year's Eve was a glass of champagne from my best mate, Ron, who then proceeded to cuddle up with his boyfriend in the corner. And there I was, as usual, standing on my own. You know the penguin? You know that little penguin in the John Lewis advert that looks into people's windows at people cuddling and longing that was him?
Oh,
that was me. That's me.
Oh,
how sad is that?
Well, but, I think. Do you know what? I love your inspiration today.
If I get a selfie stick, then obviously that will all change, as it has done for you.
Well, yes, but. also, I love your inspiration this morning. I love, because last Easter I lost weight. You were so influential with the weight loss thing, your commitment for Lent, and being a Catholic as well, I was there with you. And I think this morning, because we're only day three, anyone who wants to join in, I've started as well.
Okay.
But I think when you lose a few pounds, and myself, I think that's when things could change for us.
So I think
you could be
so.
A man magnet when you've lost your weight, like myself, and the millions of others. So
I think you're right. So I've done half a pound so far. So looking at that, by this time next week, I'm hoping to be 13 stone, 12 and a half.
Oh,
don't
lovely.
Set your target too high, because if you don't reach it, you'll be really upset. So if you think you can lose 3 pounds in a week, right? So say you're 12 stone, like I'm 13 now. So I'm 13 stone. If I think I can lose 3 pounds in a week, which actually is quite a lot, then I'll be happy if I can get from 13 to 12, 12 and a half. So my target is 1.5 pounds.
Brilliant.
Instead of three. Do you see what
Brilliant.
I mean? Right?
That's
so
the way
if I
to
get,
do it. That's
yes,
the way to do
yes.
it. Because you've got all the long winter. I look at it, the winter months are quite slow months. A couple of pounds a week. Just cut out a few of those things. And, of course, it's Christmas is passing now, so there's not the mince pies. Christmas pudding has almost been eaten. The sweets are run out. All the gift giving.
Yeah,
all the sweets.
Yeah.
And then that's it. Have your enjoyment. And then I look at it. Spring comes. The crocuses will be popping up.
Oh,
the flowers. Oh.
I love spring.
Oh,
I love.
So
I've got loads of bulbs in my garden this year. I've put loads in at the end of last year, and not all this, because what I used to do is get a big sack of daffodils and put all those in. I've got all different ones now, and they should all come up at different times.
Oh, lovely.
So what was
the Alan Titchmarsh then? You're quite the Alan Titchmarsh.
I quite like his show on ITV. What else was it you were gonna say? You wanted to talk
Big
about
Brother.
Something else?
So starting this week.
What
Celebrity
is?
Big Brother.
Oh,
and I'm hoping
God.
They've got Katie Hopkins in there.
No.
She's stirring up the nation.
Katie
she's
Hopkins.
She's a lady. Do you know about her, Chris?
You asked
she's
me about...
She's a lady
you asked
that
me...
is going on about fat people. She hates
yeah.
fat people. I mean, they've even rung up the police about her, saying that she's committed
I think,
a
I think
crime
she's,
against
I think she's
humanity.
Dreadful. I think she's absolutely dreadful. The first, the first big thing that she said was that she didn't want her children playing with children of council tenants or something like that. I think she's awful, and I think if that's the only way that you can get noticed and be famous, then I think you're a very, very sad individual.
Well, yeah, I don't think she... The trouble is with these celebrity types, they don't have enough positive... You know, you don't mind a flawed person. Everyone's flawed. But she, I can't see that anything redeeming about her.
No. No.
Anyone can write. She's got a column in the Sun. I mean, anyone can write. Anyone can communicate and tell a good story and yet be business-minded. Because I think she was... Was she an apprentice, Chris?
She was an apprentice. I think that's where she, that's how she's got most of her jobs.
Mm.
I really do.
She was quite good in that.
Yeah.
But then I think...
Yeah.
We need to get her in the Celebrity Big Brother house.
Yeah. Awful. Awful. No, I'm not... You know I won't be watching that crap.
I know you won't. I know you won't. But it does make good TV.
It doesn't make good TV. It's crap. How can you take off Dallas? How can you cancel Dallas and then put something like that on?
I know. And you met your Sue Ellen. I love...
My recent meeting with Sue Ellen was one of the highlights of my life. Let me tell you that now.
Oh, Chris. Well, it's wonderful you met her.
It is. So you know, Katie Hopkins, no,
she's
not
an A-lister. She's a total A-lister. Put her
oh,
in
God, yeah. Absolutely.
You'd probably watch Big Brother if they put her in, wouldn't you?
You've still got time. Yes, I would. You've still got time to watch, to go and see her, you know, Cinderella in New Wimbledon Theatre. She's
still
on, yes. Another couple of... I don't know exactly when it finishes, to be honest. And I think... do you want me to look it up?
No, it's okay, Chris.
No,
I'll
look it up
it.
Yourself. But I think you've got another few, maybe a couple of weeks to go. I don't know yet.
Have you been to that candle shop in Wimbledon? There's this most beautiful candle shop. They've got one in Blackheath Village near me. Well, they've got the candles in this little shop.
Right.
But apparently it's called Neon. And they're
no.
the most beautiful scented candles and sprays. And it's like a candle experience. You go in, there's beautiful smells. It's like an emporium of of deliciousness.
No, don't know it.
It's called Neon. They're classy candles and air scenters, and they all the celebrities are on them, but they're organic and they're aromatherapy, and oh my God, I've smelt them in Blackheath, and oh my God, yeah, they're amazing. But
wow.
I think that's out your way. Next time you're passing in Wimbledon, go in and check it out. You'll love it.
My best Neon mate loves candles. Ronnie loves candles.
Does he?
Oh, he's got all these.
Adore this shop.
All these smelling things all over the house. What do you don't work, do you, Anne? I can't remember.
Well, I sort of look after my mum, but I'm like many of the middle-aged people of Britain. I've sort of lost my way a little bit.
Well,
I do my karaoke.
Well, I'm going to leave you with this thought then. Look at
go
this.
For
now,
it.
Now this story, again in the Mail, it says over 60s. But for over 60s, let's read over 45-ishes. Is that all right?
Yeah, I'm 47.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the rise of the over 60s apprentices rushing to learn new trades. Okay, employers find younger workers lack the right skills and work ethic. And we all know this. We all know this. The amount of people, got sore throat, I can't go to work today.
Mm.
And all that, people like that. It says here, far from slowing down as they near retirement age, more and more over 60s are learning a new trade as apprentices.
Wow.
Isn't that interesting?
Oh,
the thing
good
is,
for them.
Well, the thing is,
young, isn't it? 60 really is like the new 50. It's not old 60,
no,
is it?
No, it's not. It's not. The number of workers aged 60 or over taking up placements has now soared from 400 to 2,480
wow.
in the past 5 years. It's thought employers are opting for older staff as they find younger workers lack the right skills and work ethic. And the work ethic thing is that, you know, they fancy taking a day off. They just ring in sick.
Oh, dear.
It's like they want to work when they feel like doing it.
Well, I never, ever took a sickie. It was unheard of when I was growing up.
Yeah.
Never, ever.
No, same here. Same here. You never,
I didn't even think of it. Never occurred. You just worked through. But
yes.
I think a lot of the people in their 60s are wonderful people. They grew up in the times of the sort of hippie era. I find they're the baby boomers, aren't they? They're really free-spirited. They've got loads to offer. They're not really, really old or anything.
No.
And they've got open minds.
No.
And like a lot of us, we're all still trying to handle technology. And
You employ someone over 45, 50, I guarantee you they will be more reliable than someone below 25. Absolutely no doubt in my mind at all. If it not everyone, don't get me, I'm not casting everyone with the same, tarring everyone with the same brush here. But if you took like 1,000 old people and 1,000 young people, who do you think would be the more reliable ones?
I know, but there's some fabulous young people out there.
There is.
There really is.
It's
hard to generalise. But, I mean, I do listen to LBC like yourself, Chris. And the other night I was coming back from somewhere and I heard this employer who's got a massive construction company.
Yes.
And he was actually saying a lot of his people he takes on are people from abroad, a lot of foreigners, and how they just work.
Yeah, they do as well.
It's so sad to hear because we're British people. We know how our country is. I mean, what we need is someone like you for Prime Minister, Chris. That's what we really need. Because if you've got inspired leadership, the country would just shape up a bit. But what do you really think of our Prime Minister, Clegg and Cameron? How do you think they've done this year, really? Come
Chris.
What would you choose?
Anne, we're at 1 o'clock, so I'm going to have to go, my darling. All right?
Okie dokie.
Yeah, but I would say, like, I don't mean all young people. That would be wrong. But a lot of them. A lot of them, I would say, elderly people would be more reliable. That's what I reckon. I absolutely reckon. Not everyone, the majority, though. That's what
I think. Well, Chris, for Prime Minister, we'll back you, Chris. When you save up your £6,000 to enter, we'll be there for you, all right?
Save up, dear? I beg your pardon?
Because I think you have to save up a few grand to run for as an MP. I think you do a great job.
Thanks for calling in. Don't forget,
Saturday.
If you want any shopping done, go and do it now before you can't go out after 2 o'clock because it's so dangerous where you live.
Bye.
Ta-da, Anne. Right, there's Anne calling from Lewisham. A couple of messages to go before we disappear today. Marge says it was $5,000 for my mum's hospital ambulance for 1 week before she died. Medicare and Medicaid only covered all but $700, which they wrote off because she died. So that's interesting to find out what that says there, Marge. Thank you very much, darling. And finally, an email from Craig. Hello, Craig, who we haven't heard from for a while. Hello, Craig, who says, hello, Chris. Good afternoon to you. Hope you're well. Happy New Year to you and all at United Kingdom Talk. Hope you're all going to have a great 2015. I noticed last Christmas Eve and the week before leading up to Christmas, people seem to go mad in shops. You can't move. But this year, it seemed all right. In our local Asda store, there wasn't cars all up our main road parked all up for shopping in Asda like there has been in previous years. Our total Christmas Eve spending was just over £20 on food shopping. Can't be bad. Well, you must have sat there starving at Christmas, Craig. How can you just spend £20 on Christmas shopping for food? I mean, I know some people that spent 80 quid on a blooming turkey. Not me, I hasten to add. I'm not eating dead animals, no thank you. Craig says, well, to my Christmas day was rubbish. I was in bed all day with a very bad cold, didn't get up. I was aching, sweating. I did manage to watch Doctor Who very late that day, so no Christmas dinner for me or my mum. She caught the same thing too. Oh, you poor thing. Then my dad got it, but we're all recovering from a very bad cold now. I'm almost 100% better. We didn't do anything for New Year's Eve. That was a bit of a downer. Never mind, hey, I'm hoping to be back doing my hospital radio show this coming Friday for my first show of 2015. Take care. Happy New Year to everyone, including Ronnie and you, Chris. Take care. And that's from Craig. So thank you very much for that, Craig. Lovely to hear from you, sir. You know, don't be a stranger. Let's hear from you a little bit more often. And let me see if I've finished all my little messages. Don't like to leave anyone out. Anyone there? That one's done. That one's done. That one's done. Yes, I think we're done today. And, of course, on Tuesday is the 6th of January. So I think I got that right, haven't I? Referring to my Barry Manilow 2015 calendar on the wall there. Tuesday is the 6th of January. You must take your Christmas decorations on that day down, OK? So this time next week, you won't see the Christmas tree or the revolving star behind me. That will be replaced once again by the mirror ball. Must take them all down by the 12th night, which is January the 6th. All right, that's it today. I do daily short videos Tuesday through to Friday. You can find those by going to unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk and click on the, you'll see two boxes there, okay? On the left-hand box is the most recent Saturday video, and on the right-hand box is the daily short video. So once again, you can find those at unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk. If you want to download the audio-only version of the show at any times, that is available free of charge on iTunes. Once again, if you just go to unitedkingdomtalk.co.uk and you'll find a link there. Okay, it says link, direct link to direct link to audio-only show. All right, that's it today, boys and girls. Thank you very much for joining us. I shall see you again for another live show next Saturday. Have a good weekend. Bye-bye now.